This time on PedalBox, I've drafted in some help from across the pond to try and get my Thunderbird running, because honestly, I really don't know what I'm doing.
Makes two of us.
So last time we were working on this car, it was a very anticlimactic finish. We got all of the wiring done for our starter motor, and then the starter motor failed. It did absolutely nothing. Even bench testing it with a battery directly connected just made sparks and a bit of smoke. But now we have some new parts, and hopefully I'm going to invoke John from Mad Scientist Garage to try and get this thing running. That said, John's speciality is not Fords.
No, it's Oldsmobiles and Pontiacs and Chevrolets and not this. But it's a carburetor and points. You can kind of just hit it until it runs.
Yeah, pretty much. It's not the most complicated system in the world, and that's pretty much what I'm banking on. But there's a bunch of things we need to get on before we get to even trying to think about cranking the key. We've got to put the expansion tank back on with the thermostat. We've got to reconnect up a couple of other hoses. We've got to reconnect the carburetor with all of its vacuum lines and work out what we do and don't need. And redo the plugs, because we forgot to put them back on when we attempted vaguely to compression test the engine once upon a time. So that was pointless and made our life more difficult now, which is exactly the pedal box way. Now, you might remember from the last time we worked on the Thunderbird that this is our old starter motor. Now, I'm not going to try and put any power through it because I'm fairly certain it is dead, and I'm pretty certain I also have the piece of video from last time showing that it does nothing when powered up to a battery besides spark and smoke. This is our new starter motor, which is, as you can see, an identical unit, which you would kind of hope from ordering the same part number, and this one is lovely and clean, and nope, that solenoid is holding that in. Kind of expected that to be as much. I'm going to throw this into the vise, throw a bit of power on from our little battery, and see whether or not this spins and engages. And if it does, we can put it on the car. And this is what the new starter does when you put some power to it. So this one works fine. So our new starter motor works perfectly. Now we can throw it back on the car. Conveniently, when Chris took the old one out, all the bolts for it are in the respective holes, which is extremely useful, because I have a habit of losing bolts to just the void on this car. But I think I have everything I need to also put the hood back on today, which would be really, really nice, rather than having to lift the damn thing off each time. So, starter motor first. We'll get that in because that should be nice and easy, and then we can use this to find TDC, I guess. Just bump it over and see where we get to, and maybe think about trying to get spark plugs back in the right order.
That's fairly crucial. And of course, Ford cylinder one is on the right.
Apparently. I would have to look this up. He knows.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Which is apparently not what anybody else does. All of the other manufacturers go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 1 and 8, are, 1 and 5 are opposite each other. But on this, 1 and 8 are still at opposite corners.
Yes.
Despite being a completely different cylinder numbering system, let alone firing order.
Yeah, and they start on opposite sides. So this being the driver's side on all American cars, one is usually driver's side.
Brilliant.
Except Ford.
Except for, okay,
for some reason.
Well.
And there are three different firing orders, I think, if I remember correctly. So
fortunately,
Cleveland and Mod Motors are different.
Yeah.
FEs and Big Blocks are different.
Fantastic. Fortunately, we have the big book of knowledge that Chris and I have been using repeatedly in order to try and find this out. And that will, if it doesn't have that in, I'm going to be really, really disappointed, but it will. So let's get the starter motor back on. Let's get the creeper out because it is still raining. We've got the tent up today just to try and keep a little bit of the rain off because John's time here is limited. He in fact flies back tomorrow. So we need to get as much of this done with his brain as possible. And that means throwing up this very, very old gazebo, which may or may not leak.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, if it does start leaking, we might not get quite as much video as we otherwise would. But we'll figure it out in the cliff notes.
We've got to make this thing run, or we're going to lose the
tent. We're going to lose the tent! Actually, if the wind picks up anymore, we might lose the tent.
Ooh, let's get to it.
Well, we got the starter motor on, which was a little bit more of a chore because all the bolts are extremely hard to access, but that was successfully redone. We've also gone through the spark plugs and just given them a clean up as well before they get tightened back up. Make sure there's no corrosion or gruff or anything like that in the threads that might have fallen in, and cleaned up the points on the top with a little Dremel. So, given it has now got extremely heavy, at least compared to what it was like before, I'm going to take this camera inside the house because it has a nice big open vent on the top, which is great for performance, but pretty terrible if it gets full of water. So I'm going to revert back to a bit of phone video if we need it. In the meantime, we're going to finish up the plugs on that side and generally start noodling around some of the wiring that we took apart when we were testing the starter motor and the relay to try and get that sorted. So it's all going to be a bit boring at least. You're not going to miss a great deal, but we'll get back to this as soon as we can. Now you might remember we put the carburetor on and we didn't really connect everything up and we didn't even inspect it that much. It was more just to put it on, keep it safe, stop it getting damaged and sit under the bonnet where it wouldn't get wet. It wouldn't let any more water into the intake, and it would generally just kind of be in the right place. However, there were a bunch of things we should have checked beforehand, which John is now about to go through.
Perfect time to open up an engine.
So, that's good. That's definitely going to need a gasket. That would be a vacuum leak. So that's one thing. When you put down your gaskets, just smear axle grease all over them. They'll always come off like brand new. So the heat cycles won't stick into this. You won't have to razor blade it. It's really nice.
And whoever did that before us didn't put the axle grease on because we had to scrape that whole thing off, even though it had been barely heat cycled. So that wasn't particularly good. Everything was glued down to that phenolic spacer. So that's a really good tip. Remember that, because I probably won't, and I'll need to do this at some point.
So, great news. This is a Holley. It's the carburetor I know the least about, but I'll tell you a little bit here. Holley's easy to identify, number one, text, but any Holley-style carburetor is going to have an end tank on each side. This one is a single feed, so there's just one inlet here and a little tube between. There are also dual feeds that have a big pipe kind of between them. What we're intending to do right now is set it so it'll idle, and that requires just a minimum amount of air bleed between these butterflies and your outside. So, number one, whether it's automatic or manual choke, set your choke open. If this is closed, you're gonna have a bad time. So make sure your choke is set open. And what we're looking for, there are these transfer slots. If you look very closely inside of that bore, and what we're trying to make that is a square. So we're gonna adjust the idle screw on this arm over here until it sits at square. So those are your transfer slots. As you kick this over, it's going to bleed a little more air than just what is on the outside of this circle. So you want to set those just so that little transfer slot is a square. And it actually looks to me, dab that with my thumb, that actually looks pretty good. So whoever set this did a pretty nice job. That will probably idle.
And that definitely wasn't me that set that, it was the guy that I bought this carb off, whose name currently escapes me, but if I can remember, I will throw it up in the edit and put it in the comments down below.
Obviously we're adapting a carburetor that's not stock for this, that's fine, you just need to understand the functions of the vacuum ports. You'll see this one here is underneath the throttle blades, so that's the same vacuum that you're going to get from the intake manifold here, or this other port you see right here, not to mention your manifold. So you got a bunch of places you can hook up your power brakes, you can hook up other things like a transmission kickdown. Certain cars will need that for the transmission to work properly. We really don't need most of that, so we're going to end up capping this off with a hose or a vacuum cap if you've got it. The other one we have is ported, so this is taking vacuum from above the butterflies. It's not going to see vacuum until you hit the throttle and the butterflies open. So that is what's going to end up controlling this right here for our vacuum advance, and all we're gonna have to do is just run a little tiny piece of hose for that to work. But pretty simple. It's a Holley vacuum secondary, perfect size, drops right on. I'm hoping we can just throw a couple gaskets at it quick and I'll kind of fiddle with it. Probably replace this while we're at it. That's definitely a vacuum leak. So there again, you have another manifold vacuum down here that we need to just plug off since we're not using it. So, try to keep the rain out of this baby. and start fiddling with the idle settings and at least splash some gas in there, see if we can get it to fire.
Carburetor's reinstalled. We got our really fabulous Aldi brand return spring bracket there. Next thing to do is just test the coil before I worry about messing with the distributor. We tried the key, it's not cooperating, so we'll come back to that, but I want to see if this thing wants to run. So with 12 volts running directly to the positive here, you can see the negative, this wire down here, runs and grounds through the distributor. That's ultimately your path of spark. So I want to know, hey, does this make sparks? And basically, see that right there? We're getting sparks, so the points and the condenser and the coil all work. Ow! And that's how you can tell. I just took like 30,000 volts. Whew! So, this will make spark. The next thing to determine is top dead center on the engine. We're gonna spin things over, probably manually using the new starter relay. Let me show you how to do that. And then once we've figured out where the compression stroke is, using probably my thumb, then we will figure out where the rotor's pointed, and that terminal on this distributor cap will be number one. So, pretty easy from there. Cylinders are numbered 1 through 4, 5 through 8. We'll just run through the firing order and splash some gas in it. So, the good news, we were able to verify that the relay works using this little tester gadget. These things are awesome. Bad news, we're not getting 12 volts from the key switch to this relay. So, everything works. I can make the relay click, no problem. We'll need to get a battery in here to get away from the voltage drop. But there appears to be probably a broken wire, a fusible link missing. Something is not happy from here to here that there's never 12 volt output to engage the start relay. So we have some digging to do there, and maybe we'll see if we can try to either run this directly off an alternator or find a battery that fits in this hole so we can test the starter properly by bypassing things. I know how to hotwire it so we can make it run for a few seconds, but there does appear to have an electrical problem, probably from this wiring kind of being torched or just, you know, 60-ish years of age. So I would be checking that there's constant 12 volts under the dash, then check that you're getting 12 volts to the key switch, and that finally your key switch is sending voltage here. Hi there, neighbor. I believe I found the problem. There's this little hilarious short piece of broken wire right here on a fusible link block that we couldn't see because it was covered with our janky test leads and boxes to insulate. So probably what happened, this broke or melted or, you know, aged out, and now it's not supplying any power to the dash. We've checked the 60-ish year old shop manual and it says, yes, in fact, this is your only fuse to supply power to the inside of the car.
Well, there is a fuse box under the dash as well.
Sure, this powers that.
But so, yeah, that's the main input into the rest of the car.
Yeah.
Which,
so, if you were desperate and not worried about a fire, which we are, you could just, you know, short these two together and just hope that the rest of the wiring is a fuse instead of this visible small gauge wire that we have. We're not going to do that. We will just kind of install the battery at a 45 degree angle like you're really not supposed to. So we have enough positive lead here. The negative will probably reach wherever we need it to be. So that'll at least allow us to get rid of our voltage drop from those clamps and hopefully test the starter that we installed. From there, I'll just show you how to hotwire everything, which you should only do to your own car if you're desperate and not on a road for legal reasons. But we're gonna do that to test it. So I'm gonna throw that battery in and check back. So the battery is very carefully installed exactly the way the factory did it. Got our test doodad fixed back up. You can see green light means ground. Red light means positive. So this thing is working. And what I'm gonna do is just mangle this guy in here and trigger the relay manually. Ready? Contact. It's not doing the thing anymore. Everything is dead. That's That's not going to help me. Actually, no, that will help me measure the voltage.
Why are you this way? It's as if the battery no longer has any voltage.
Yep.
Why would that happen?
I will confess that this is an old battery.
Did we hook it up backwards?
No. 11.8.
Okay, we're
back
to having ground.
Which admittedly is really super low. Like, I don't think it's...
I think it's mad.
Yeah. Ground?
Yep, has ground.
Okay.
Ground. Positive. It's...
Click. Make a click.
Well, it clicked the relay once, so we know that part works.
We know the relay works. We have made progress on many other things. But, once again, the short-term quick fix, let's just do a quick brake job that has turned into a mini resto, has got away from me. Who would have thought? So I think this is going to be another day's worth of work. Because really, I would love to go through all the wiring under the dash and make sure that is all not super garbage.
So the Thunderbird saga continues. If you've enjoyed this episode, give it a like, and don't forget, if you want, you can check out some of the merch to support these projects at shop.pedalbox.show, and you can also become a patron at patreon.com/pedalboxshow. Thanks to all of our long-standing patrons, and we will see you all in the next episode.